Good morning, everyone, and thank you so much for joining us today to discuss Section 1557 of the Affordable Care Act. My name is Jennifer Curry, and I am a shareholder in the Baltimore office of Baker Donaldson. I am an employment lawyer, but I focus primarily on working with healthcare providers, and I chair the firm's L&E health practice in doing so. I am joined by my colleague, Melody Hengerer, who is also in our Baltimore office. She is a talented litigator who focuses working with healthcare providers and organ procurement organizations in a variety of issues. Together, we have a unique experience in guiding entities covered by the ACA as it relates to compliance with Section 1557 and in defending healthcare providers facing discrimination lawsuits brought under those regulations. That's why we're here today, to discuss the changes that have been made recently in the law and in the regulations under 1557, and to help you understand what your organization may need to do in order to comply. Before we get started, I have a few housekeeping notes I want to address. You will see at the bottom of your screen that there is a Q&A box for you to submit questions. Because we have a lot of ground to cover today, we may not be able to get to the questions submitted during the presentation. However, we will be collecting those questions and will respond individually after the presentation is completed. There also will be a survey sent to you at the end of the presentation. We really want to hear your feedback, so we appreciate you completing that and sending it back to us. And finally, we want to stay connected with you, and we want you to connect with us. We have both Twitter and LinkedIn pages, and the links to those are at the bottom of your screen. Both those links will keep you updated on presentations and articles that we are offering, and also keep you up to date with the legal developments that you need to know. With that, I'm going to turn it over to Melody to get us started.
Thank you so much, Jennifer, for that warm welcome and those kind words. I also, just as an initial matter, want to give a special thanks to Reba Letza, also in our Baltimore office, for her significant contribution and assistance to this webinar. So thanks, Reba. So in order to understand where we are with regard to gender discrimination in healthcare, it's important to understand the history of this area of law. And so by way of background, and as many of you probably know, Section 1557 of the Patient Protection and Affordable Care Act, or the ACA, is a comprehensive health care reform law that was enacted on March 23rd in 2010. Section 1557 generally prohibits discrimination by health care providers on the basis of race, color, national origin, sex, age, or disability. It applies to any part of any health program or activity receiving financial federal assistance. And Section 1557 is based on and modeled after existing federal civil law rights, including Title VII of the Civil Rights Act of 1964, Title IX of the Education Amendments of 1972, Section 504 of the Rehabilitation Act of 1973, and the Americans with Disability Act. Now, it's important to note that the 2016 final rule does not include an express religious exemption to enforcement, but HHS does make clear that the statute will be enforced consistent with existing laws protecting religious freedom, such as the Religious Freedom Restoration Act, or RFRA, federal conscience protection laws, and the U.S. Constitution. Now, finally, since the 2010 enactment of Section 1557, the HHS Office for Civil Rights has had the responsibility of conducting investigations of discrimination complaints filed under 1557, but courts also allow plaintiffs to pursue a private right of action under the statute. Although Section 1557 was enacted in 2010, HHS didn't issue a final rule on this section until May 18th of 2016. Another final rule was issued later this year, as Jennifer will explain to you later, but it's imperative to have a basic understanding of the 2016 final rule, as you'll see. The 2016 final rule expanded the definition of what constitutes discrimination, quote, on the basis of sex, to include prohibitions against discrimination on the basis of pregnancy, childbirth, sex stereotyping, and gender identity. Today, we're focusing on issues related to sex stereotyping and gender identity. And as you'll see, courts have interpreted these to be related concepts in some situations. Now, with specific regard to sex stereotyping, HHS has made it clear that under the 2016 final rule, its use of the term sex stereotyping was taken from the 1989 Supreme Court decision in Price Waterhouse v. Hopkins. You might recall in that case that the Supreme Court held that any discrimination based on stereotypical notions of what constitutes appropriate gender behavior, including one's appearance or mannerisms, constitutes discrimination, quote, on the basis of sex. Now, the 2016 final rule also includes an express prohibition against discrimination on gender identity. The definition of gender identity in the 2016 final rule was expanded to include protections for individuals who identify as male, female, or neither, those who identify as a combination of male and female, and individuals whose gender might be different from their biological sex at birth. So ultimately, this means that individuals who identify as transgender were expressly protected from discrimination under the 2016 final rule. So we know what was prohibited by the 2016 final rule. Now the question becomes, to whom did the rule apply? Well, it generally applied to all health programs and activities that receive federal financial assistance through HHS. That includes Medicaid, most Medicare, student plans, basic health program, and CHIP funds, many other programs. It also applied to health programs and activities that were administered by HHS and health insurance marketplaces and issuers that participate in those marketplaces. So here it's important to note that the 2016 final rule really broke new ground because it explicitly prohibited common forms of insurance and other discrimination against transgender individuals. Now, under the rule, insurers cannot categorically exclude coverage for gender-affirming services or deny, limit, or subject such services, increase cost sharing, if those impositions are discriminatorily applied. For example, HHS says that if an insurer denies coverage of a hysterectomy to treat gender dysphoria in a transgender man, HHS will scrutinize that insurer's coverage of hysterectomies for all other medical reasons in order to determine whether the denial constitutes discrimination. These same examples apply to the administration of healthcare services, the general rule being that if a service is medically necessary for the treatment of gender dysphoria or gender transitioning services, and a healthcare provider already provides those services, like a hysterectomy, for example, to a cisgender patient, it must also provide the service to a transgender patient. So in sum, it suffices to say that the 2016 final rule was sweeping in its scope and coverage. But as there was a change in the administration in 2016, also came the rollback of the 2016 final rule. On December 31, 2016, the U.S. District Court for the Northern District of Texas issued an injunction preventing HHS from enforcing the Section 1557 provisions that prohibited discrimination based on gender identity and termination of pregnancy. The case is Franciscan Alliance v. Burwell, and in that case, five states and three religiously affiliated healthcare entities filed suit challenging the expanded protections of the 2016 rule. In the lawsuit, the plaintiffs asserted that the 2016 rule compelled them to perform and provide coverage for gender transition services and abortions against their religious beliefs. They claimed this constituted a violation of the federal APA, RFRA, and the U.S. Constitution. Now, the court held that Section 1557 unambiguously referred only to biological sex discrimination, and it relied on the definition of sex as it was defined in Title IX. The court also held that the 2016 final rule unlawfully burdened the plaintiff's religious exercise under RFRA. And it's important to note that with regard to RFRA, the court concluded that the rule placed a substantial pressure on the plaintiffs to perform and cover the services. It forced the plaintiffs to provide the federal government with a non-discriminatory and exceedingly persuasive justification for their refusal to provide the services, and it required them to remove the categorical exclusion of those services. Now, although the interveners in this case urged the court to find that the government had a compelling interest in ensuring that individuals have non-discriminatory access to health care and health coverage, because the government didn't make this argument, the court failed to consider it. Again, ultimately, the court issued the nationwide injunction. However, the injunction did not completely excuse covered entities from compliance. Remember that Section 1557 provides a private right of action. So in spite of the injunction, litigation under Section 1557 continued. We'll discuss some of those cases a little bit later, but now I'll turn it back over to Jennifer for a discussion of the 2020 final rule.
Thank you, Melody. So let's advance to the next slide. Okay, so the 2020 final rule really started out early last year where HHS proposed revising the Section 1557 regulations to address the definition of, quote, on the basis of sex that was provided under the original rule. And after a pretty lengthy comment period, on June 12th, HHS announced its 2020 final rule and explained that the new regulations were meant to eliminate the overbroad provisions related to sex and gender identity. The reason HHS gave for making this change was that it believed the prior administration's final rule expanded the definition of on the basis of sex to include gender identity and basis of termination of pregnancy, which did not fit with the definition of sex under federal law at the time. HHS therefore stated that the expanded definition of that phrase was not within their authority to do, and actually amounted to what they called essentially legislative changes. HHS also explained that its revision was meant to free entities, and that was their language, who had been, quote, prevented from drawing reasonable or medically indicated distinctions on the basis of sex. The new rule set out to replace the exhaustive list that had been provided for prohibited grounds for non-discrimination included in the 2016 final rule, and replace it with a simple list of the statutes that were used as the basis for drafting Section 1557, such as Title IX. And I note that the definitions and interpretations of gender discrimination under Title IX are governed by Title VII of the Civil Rights Act, which we'll discuss more in just a minute. So the new final rule was set for publication or posted on June 12th, and it was set for publication on June 19th, when perhaps one of the biggest civil rights decisions in at least the last 5 years was handed down by the Supreme Court. On June 15th, 2020, the Supreme Court issued its decision in Bostick v. Clayton County, and which was surprisingly authored by Justice Neil Gorsuch. I mentioned Title VII during the last slide, which is a piece of the Civil Rights Act of 1964. And it prohibits discrimination in employment based on a number of, quote, protected characteristics, and that's how the law is drafted. And those protected characteristics include sex. So in Bostick, the court was asked to consider the definition of the word sex under Title VII and whether that definition includes sexual orientation and transgender status. So in other words, the court was asked to determine whether Title VII prohibits employment discrimination based on a person's sexual orientation or transgender status. To understand how Bostick came to be, I think it's helpful to understand the facts of the case. And Bostick is actually three cases from three different federal circuits that were consolidated into one for the Supreme Court decision. In the original Bostick case, the plaintiff, Gerald Bostick, was a long-term employee of the Clayton County juvenile court system, and he had a very good performance record. But in early 2013, he joined a gay softball league, and he promoted its games and events at work. After sending out those emails, a very influential member of the Clayton County government received the emails and openly criticized him for being gay and promoting an organization that supports gays. So shortly after that criticism, Clayton County conducted an audit of the government funds controlled by Mr. Bostick, and it used the results of that audit to terminate him for, quote, conduct unbecoming a county employee. So Mr. Bostick sued Clayton County in the federal court in Georgia, and that court ended up dismissing his case based on its interpretation that Title VII did not include sexual orientation as a protected characteristic. Mr. Bostick appealed the decision, and the 11th Circuit affirmed the lower court's decision. The second case that was consolidated with Bostick is Zarda v. Altitude Express. In that case, Mr. Zarda was a skydiving instructor with Altitude Express. And during a session with a female customer, he announced that he is gay and she should not worry about having to be strapped to him during their jump. He had intended to make the customer feel more comfortable about being strapped to a man. The customer complained to her boyfriend, and then the two of them complained to Altitude Express. Shortly after, the company then terminated Mr. Zarda for, quote, misconduct. Mr. Zarda sued for discriminatory termination in the New York federal court, and the court initially granted Altitude Express summary judgment based on its finding that sexual orientation was not a protected characteristic under Title VII, the same decision that the lower court came to in the original Bostick case. Mr. Zarda then appealed, and instead this time, the Second Circuit overruled the lower court's decision, finding that sexual orientation was protected under Title VII. So that was then appealed up to the Supreme Court. And the third case, and possibly the most factually interesting case, is the EEOC versus RG and GR Harris Funeral Homes, which I'm going to refer to as Harris Funeral Homes. In that case, a longtime employee of the Harris Funeral Homes, Amy Stevens, who had always presented herself as male, notified the funeral home in 2013 that she would be undergoing gender reassignment surgery and that after a vacation, she would return to work as a woman. She would be wearing women's clothes and she would have a new name. Shortly after giving that notice, the funeral home terminated her. After going through the charging process with the EEOC, the EEOC actually took up the case on Ms. Stevens' behalf and filed suit in federal court in Michigan. The Michigan court found in favor of the funeral home and dismissed the case, holding again that Title VII did not cover transgender status as a protected characteristic. Ms. Stevens appealed to the Sixth Circuit, which reversed the decision and held that transgender status is in fact protected. So between these three cases, there presented a clear split in the federal circuit that needed to be decided by the Supreme Court as to whether transgender status and sexual orientation are protected under Title VII. So that's where we get to the Bostick holding. The Supreme Court found that Title VII's use of the word sex does in fact include sexual orientation and transgender status. And thus it takes an adverse employment action against an individual based on either of those traits to be an unlawful sex discrimination action. Justice Gorsuch reached this finding, and he explained that Title VII relies on a but-for analysis, meaning that if an employer takes an action against an employee for traits or actions that are associated with their sexual orientation or their transgender status, that it would not have taken against members of a different sex, then sex has clearly played a role in that employment decision and thus constitute unlawful discrimination. The justice did give an example to explain it in better context. And the example came to when an employer has both a male employee and a female employee. Both of those employees announce that they are getting married to a man. If the employer terminates the male employee, but not the female employee, for marrying a man, then the employer's decision is based on the male employee's sexual orientation or his sex, and it is a decision that the employer did not take with the female employee who is not gay. So as a result, that relates to, or that equates to, sexual orientation discrimination or sex discrimination prohibited by Title VII. So obviously, this Bostic decision settled the circuit court split, and it has a very serious impact on the definitions and interpretations of the meaning of sex in a variety of contexts, including other federal and state laws that are based on Title VII or were drafted to mirror Title VII. For example, a lot of states have their own anti-discrimination statutes as it relates to employment. And those were largely drafted based on Title VII and how Title VII came into be. And the case law interpreting those states' laws also rely heavily on case law interpreting Title VII. So the decision in BASTA could very well mean that sexual orientation and transgender status is not only going to be covered under federal law, but will also be covered under state employment law, even if not explicitly stated in those laws. So as we already discussed, the language of the 2020 final rule was issued on June 12th, but it was not set to be published until June 19th. Then BOSIC was issued in between there on June 15th, changing the federal definition of sex for discrimination purposes. Yet HHS did not address that change and move forward with publishing the final rule as it had been drafted, including the rollback of the protections for on the basis of sex provided under the prior rule, and they did so on June 19th. So clearly there was certain to be some kind of showdown as to the final rule and how it would be set to take effect in mid-August, and there was. So we have two federal courts that actually weighed in. The first federal court, it was in New York, weighed in on the issue under Walker v. Azar. In that case, two transgender individuals with serious medical conditions filed suit in June, and they alleged that they were discriminated against by their healthcare providers based on their transgender status. They argued that their past experiences would cause them to avoid undergoing any necessary medical fear in the future because they were fearful of further discrimination. They asserted that the rollback of the protections for those who are transgender under the new final rule was not in line with the current state of federal law. So the new final rule was set to take effect on August 18th, but on August 17th, just one day before that, the court ruled that the 2020 final rule was inconsistent with the holding in Bostic, and it addressed that for two reasons. First, it adopted the idea that this long-standing statutory interpretation of sex was based on the plain meaning of the word, and that meaning essentially that biologically male or female as determined at birth. Second, the court also noted that the new rule rejected the idea that sex-based discrimination included discrimination based on gender identity and sex stereotype. As a result, the court determined that HHS had acted arbitrarily or capriciously in publishing the new final rule. It failed to address the Bostic new definition of on the basis of sex, and therefore the court stayed the implementation specifically of the definition of discrimination on the basis of sex. So that's the only piece of the final rule that was stayed. The second federal court to weigh in was in DC. And this time it was in the case of Whitman Walker Clinic versus HHS. The plaintiffs in that case are a coalition of a variety of healthcare providers and civil rights groups that focus primarily on providing care and resources to the LGBTQ+ community. The plaintiffs filed suit seeking a preliminary injunction against the implementation of the new final rule, based specifically on the fact that it violated the text of the ACA and Congress's intent to address critical failures in the American healthcare system as it relates to those vulnerable Americans, including those in the LGBTQ community. And of course, it also they also argued that the final rule was inconsistent with Bostick. So on September 2nd, the D.C. Circuit Court issued a preliminary injunction against the implementation of the 2020 final rule, as it relates, again, to the new definition of on the basis of sex. The injunction instructed HHS to immediately stop its attempt to carve out the LGBTQ community from protections under the ACA that they should be afforded. So where are we now? This is where things currently stand. Bostick is the law of the land, and its definition of sex does include sexual orientation and transgender status. And it's effective in every area covered by or connected in any way to Title VII. That would include Section 1557, which is based on Title IX, which is based on Title VII. So the rollback of the protections for sexual orientation and transgender status that were attempted by HHS with the new final rule have been stayed and did not take effect, although all the other revisions did actually take effect. As a result, the healthcare providers covered by Section 1557 should move forward with compliance under the final rule, with the understanding that protections against discrimination based on sex remain originally stated as under the 2016 final rule. And now I'll turn it back over to Melody to talk about litigation under Section 1557.
Thanks so much, Jennifer. So as Jennifer mentioned, not only is Bostick the law of the land, but the 2016 final rule is now also the law of the land with regard to gender identity discrimination in healthcare. And so it's helpful now to understand how these claims arise and how they're decided. So we put together a few case summaries to show how courts have applied Section 1557. And so historically, any of those interpreting the 2016 final rule are also relevant. So the first case is one from 2018. So in Boyden v. State of Wisconsin, two transgender female plaintiffs, both of whom were state employees, filed suit against the secretary of the Wisconsin Department of Employee Trust Funds. The state's health care insurance coverage expressly excluded coverage for procedures, services, and supplies related to gender reassignment. The plaintiff's suit alleged that the exclusion was in violation of Section 1557 and the Equal Protection Clause of the 14th Amendment. Now, the employer, which was the state, argued that the exclusion was not discriminatory because it didn't completely bar the plaintiffs from, quote, living their true gender identity. The court disagreed, though. It reasoned that the state's policy compelled transgender individuals to maintain the physical characteristics of their biological sex, which the state perceived as more acceptable. And so the court held that the state employer's exclusion of gender reassignment procedures and supplies implicated sex stereotyping, as we discussed previously, because importantly, it, number one, limited the availability of medical transitioning, and number two, it made it economically infeasible for transgender patients to receive services. Now, notably in this case, the court struck down the exclusion and the case proceeded to a jury trial where the plaintiffs were awarded a favorable jury verdict of $780,000. By way of another example, we have the Tovar case. So similarly, in 2018, Brittany Tovar filed suit in the U.S. District Court for the District of Minnesota. She alleged that her son was denied coverage for healthcare programs which were necessary for his transition from female to male. Tovar was employed as a family nurse practitioner at in an Ascensia Health Hospital, and her employers employee medical plan also have specifically excluded services and or surgery for gender reassignment. So when the insurer declined coverage for her son, Tovar filed suit, and she asserted that the exclusion clause in Essentia's medical plan ran afoul of the non-discrimination provision of 1557 because it discriminated against her son on the basis of his transgender status. Now, the hospital argued that Section 1557 does not expressly provide protections for discrimination based on, quote, transgender status. But as we know, the courts have previously relied on Price Waterhouse, which holds that the sex stereotyping is a form of sex discrimination, and accordingly, transgender status also a form of sex stereotyping. So we talked a little bit about discrimination in insurance coverage, but it's also critical to recognize that there are other actionable forms of gender discrimination that can expose healthcare providers to liability and, more importantly, can be potentially harmful to patients. So the Prescott case is an example of one of those cases. In Prescott, a mother filed suit against a children's hospital alleging that the hospital violated Section 1557 by repeatedly misgendering her son during a hospital visit. Her son unfortunately committed suicide 6 weeks after visiting the hospital. The district court denied the hospital's motion to dismiss and allowed the plaintiff's claim to go forward. But when the court conducted its analysis of the plaintiff's claim, it reasoned that the claim could advance because there were several federal circuits that had interpreted the sex discrimination provisions of Title VII and Title IX to protect transgender individuals from discrimination. And the court noted that the allegations in the complaint were sufficient to allege the hospital staff refused to treat her son as a boy due to his gender nonconformance. Now, this is the precise form of sex-based discrimination that Title VII and, as Jennifer noted, by extension, Title IX were enacted to prevent. So in addition to holding that the transgender discrimination was prohibited by Section 1557, the court also held that the patient's mother, as personal representative of her son's estate, had standing to sue under the ACA to recover damages for her son's emotional distress. Now, eventually this case settled, but it's certainly a devastating case that should prompt healthcare providers to re-examine their sensitivity training processes, which Jennifer will also discuss a little bit later. In addition to Section 1557 gender protections, a number of states have similar and even more stringent protections against this type of healthcare discrimination. So it's critical to have an understanding of these protections in your own state, but we've highlighted some state cases for your information by way of some examples here. So the first one is Good versus Iowa Department of Human Services. This is a 2019 case in which two transgender women, both with a diagnosis of gender dysphoria, sought a review of denial of coverage from Iowa's Medicaid program for their gender reassignment surgeries. Now, Iowa's Medicaid program generally provided coverage for medically necessary services and supplies provided by physicians, but those services were subject to an exclusion for cosmetic surgeries. And the cosmetic surgeries excluded were procedures related to transsexualism, hermaphroditism, gender identity disorders, or body dysmorphic disorders. So DHS argued that the exclusion of gender reassignment surgery did not discriminate based on gender identity because it applied equally to transgender and cisgender Medicaid beneficiaries alike. Well, the court wasn't buying it, and the court rejected the argument and held that the Iowa Administrative Code permits the Medicaid program to fund other cosmetic procedures that serve psychological purposes, such as revisions of disfigurements and scarring, while it also denied coverage to transgender individuals for similar procedures. The court also reasoned that the administrative code's exclusion of gender reassignment procedures from Medicaid was contrary to the intent of the legislature when the provision of Iowa's Civil Rights Act prohibiting discrimination on the basis of gender identity was enacted. So ultimately, the court ruled in favor of the plaintiffs and struck down the exclusion, finding that it was a violation of Iowa's civil rights. So this last case is truly one to watch. It pits religious rights squarely against the rights of transgender individuals to receive equal treatment in the healthcare space. And this is a case that I've been following for quite some time. I think it's a fascinating case. I would also note that there are several similar cases pending in other states across the country and in federal courts. And we'll talk a little bit later about what this means for the future. But as an initial matter, so this is Minton v. Dignity Health, and it involved a transgender male who was scheduled for a hysterectomy at Mercy Hospital, which is a Catholic hospital in San Diego. Now, Mr. Minton's surgeon scheduled the surgery and told him that his hysterectomy was medically necessary for the treatment of his gender dysphoria. But 2 days before the surgery was scheduled, a nurse at Mercy Hospital found out that Mr. Minton was transgender, and the hospital notified the surgeon and Mr. Minton that the procedure was going to be canceled. The president of the hospital explained that as a Catholic hospital, it is bound by the ethical and religious directives for Catholic healthcare services, or the ERDs, and those prohibit sterilization, including hysterectomies, unless there is a serious threat to the life of the health of the patient. So ultimately, Mr. Minton was able to have his surgery at a different hospital just 2 days after it was originally scheduled. But Mr. Minton filed suit against the hospital, claiming he was discriminated against based on his gender identity. And he filed this case as a violation of California's Civil Rights Act called the UNRU Act. And so notably, there's no involvement of Section 1557 here, or at this point in the case, any other federal rights. So this was just a state case. But in its defense, the hospital argued that its constitutional freedom of religion supersedes Mr. Minton's right to service. But a California appellate court recently held that, quote, any burden that state law places on the exercise of religion is justified by California's compelling interest in ensuring full and equal access to medical treatment for all its residents. So if you'll recall from our earlier discussion the Franciscan Alliance case, this was the exact argument that the government in that case failed to make. So here we have the weighing of the constitutional freedom of religion argument versus the right to full and equal access to medical treatment. So ultimately, the California appellate court sided with Mr. Minton, holding that the hospital's refusal to perform his hysterectomy and its failure to provide alternative options to get the procedure was a violation of the state human rights law, because again, it denied him full and equal access to medical treatment. So in March of this year, Dignity Health filed a writ of certiorari to the Supreme Court. So based on the Supreme Court calendar, we should know very soon whether or not the Supreme Court is going to hear this case. And again, even though Section 1557 is not at issue in the Minton case, freedom of religion as it functions in the healthcare space is on the table here. And so if the Supreme Court chooses to hear this case, it's definitely going to have a massive effect on the landscape of healthcare discrimination law, particularly given that approximately 1 in 6 beds in the U.S. are in religious hospitals. So we're not sure what will happen here, and no one is, but perhaps the court might wait to decide whether or not they'll hear this case once the court is full. But that goes into issues that are beyond the scope of this presentation today. But in any event, there's no doubt that the Minton case is one to watch. So I'm going to turn it back over to Jennifer now for some practical takeaways.
Thanks, Melody. So there are obviously going to still be compliance obligations you're going to have. There are new ones under the new the new rule not covered by this presentation. But there are continuing obligations that you have to you have to observe as it relates to protections on the basis of sex under the 2016 final rule. So there are four areas your organization should really review and address in making sure that it is in compliance with the prohibition of discrimination on the basis of sex in healthcare situations. And that's to include sexual orientation, sex stereotyping, and transgender status. Our first recommendation is that you review your policies and practices related to patient care and your interactions with the public to ensure that they are meeting the standards for protections against discrimination on the basis of sex. Second, you want to confirm that your Section 1557 compliance coordinator understands the status of the law and the regulations and its impact on your practice or those who you serve. Obviously, this means you need to have a compliance coordinator, and assuming that you do, that person needs to be up to date with where things are and what your organization is required to comply with. Next, you should make sure that your Section 5057 grievance procedure includes the proper definition of sex as it's defined under the 2016 rule, at least at this point. And to make sure that those who participate in grievances understand the meaning of sex under current federal law, your grievance procedure should, at least at this point, include identifying individuals that would be part of hearing appeals or hearing complaints or grievances. So those individuals need to make sure that those individuals understand their obligations, understand the law, and understand how it needs to be applied so that when they are participating in the grievance process, that they are doing so in the right way, and that make sure your organization is obviously protected as well as it can be. And the fourth piece that's probably the most important is that and needs to be addressed for compliance purposes, is focused on training. And that's for both those who oversee your Section 1557 program, but also those who interact with patients and members of the public, and particularly those who may face making decisions or providing treatment, and how that relates to doing so for individuals who are of a different sexual orientation or gender identity. So they need to know what discrimination based on sex means under federal law and how they must protect individuals who have a variety of different traits under that definition. Supervisors and managers should be trained to not only understand the law, but also to be able to understand and answer questions posed by employees who are faced with a variety of situations, patients who have issues as it relates to their care or confidentiality regarding their sexual orientation or transgender status, or have complaints about how they are treated as it relates to their sex. We should also be able to answer questions and respond to issues from members of the public, because at the end of the day, Section 1557 provides protections not only against discrimination for patient care, but also it protects members of the public who might face discrimination in your organization as a healthcare provider. So beyond supervisors and managers, you should also make sure your employees who are actually providing care and interacting with members of the public are trained on diversity and sensitivity as it relates to the definition of sex and the protections against discrimination based on sex. And it should also understand how to respond to various issues from different communities, including those in the LGBTQ+ community. They should be trained on proper terms to use and how to address individuals based on their preferences. and should understand the different definitions of sex and the individuals who are protected based on their sex. So, you know, it's because it's important at the end of the day that these issues be handled appropriately and with sensitivity and taken seriously, and that employees understand that if they're faced with a question or faced with an issue in this arena, that they know where to go for help in responding to a patient or a member of the public, or helping a patient or a member of the public who might have who might fall within one of these categories. And so with that, we actually did finish up quite early. We've reached the end of our presentation. Please, if you have any further questions, we ask that you email us. You can reach me at jcurry@bakerdonaldson.com or melody@mhengerer@bakerdonaldson.com. For those of you who did submit questions to us during the presentation, we will answer those separately. We thank you very much for joining us today. We hope you enjoyed the presentation. Please make sure to complete the survey at the end of the presentation. And if you have any issues or questions related to your organization specifically, please do not hesitate to reach out to us. We look forward to seeing you again in the future for other webinars and other opportunities. Have a great rest of your day.